Hello, everybody. My name is Mike Furman, and this is the video training series for the Utah High School Football Officials Association 2022 Clinic. In this video, we will be covering keys and mechanics for wing officials. We will not spend time talking about judgment calls or fouls that should or should not have been called unless it directly relates to a mechanic or a missed key that we should have been paying attention to. So with that said, let's start right off into our first video clip. We're going to start out with free kick mechanics. You can see here on this, we have a standard free kick formation. Our back judge is positioned where he's supposed to be on the 40-yard line. We have our line judge positioned on the 50-yard line. And if we roll this clip forward, we're going to have a kick that kind of dribbles down the center of the field. And again, we'll see that our head linesman is positioned exactly where he should be on the 30-yard line. And our umpire is just off screen, positioned on the 20-yard line, with our referee also just off screen, positioned on the goal line, halfway between the middle of the field and the hash marks on the head linesman or chain side of the field. Now, these positions are exactly where the manual puts us. It is exactly where the Utah High School Football Officials Association wants us positioned. This is where we should be on, again, a standard free kick. Additionally, the most common missed mechanic that we have on free kick formations, we see it again and again and again, are between the line judge and the umpire and not understanding whose responsibility is what. As wings, we always want to spot the ball. That's what we do. That's kind of where we think of ourselves, and our job is to come in and spot the ball. That is not true on a free kick. On a free kick, and we'll roll ahead here and let you see this, it is the umpire's responsibility to come up the field and mark the spot of the ball. The line judge is to stay ahead of the play. It's only one of the only times in the game that as a line judge or a wing, you want to stay positioned ahead of the play so that we can keep it boxed in. And you can see here the line judge realized he got a little bit too deep, so he's trying to get back up out of the way because here comes the umpire pushing him out of the way to come in and spot the ball. A good rule of thumb for line judges is to not go more than 10 yards down the field on a free kick. If you go much past the 40, you're now encroaching into the umpire's territory, and we're going to have two officials watching the same area. Again, about 10 yards, any more than that, you'll need to back up. You can see here this play actually does break free a little bit, so it was necessary for the line judge to get out and give some room so the umpire now can come in with the head linesman and mark the spot. If this play were to have broken free all the way to the goal line, it would be the back judge and the line judge who needs to be at the goal line on each side to rule whether or not that person got across and we had a touchdown. So, good mechanic. The line judge had to move a little bit, but that was a good mechanic overall. On this play, we're going to see some things that we don't want to see mechanic-wise. We'll skip ahead here a little bit. There are actually a few problems with this play. Again, we're not going to talk about fouls, but there it is. We got five people back. They're back more than 5 yards. We've also probably should have had an offsides on that kick. But anyway, that's not important. What's important here is the mechanics. So, first off, well, let's start with the umpire. Just to mention that he's out of position. Okay, he's on the 10-yard line. That should never happen. Should always be on the 20-yard line. And the other big problem that we start out with here is with our line judge is that we're walking. Whether you're a new official or an old official, you need to get it ingrained into your head as a wing official. We never, ever walk on a play. If it is a live ball play, we are never walking. We either sidestep or run. And you can watch here as this happens. This really kind of presents a message of I'm just kind of out of it and don't really care what's happening on the play. Our umpire, unfortunately, on this side ends up walking too. Now we got two individuals who just look disengaged and like they're not intent on officiating like they need to be. Now, the other thing that happens on this play is both of them get beat. Our line judge is thinking that he's the one to spot the ball, and he lets the play go past him. Really, at this point, we should have our umpire up about here. Our line judge should be up here in this spot. We've got our back judge here. All right, umpires are slow, so we maybe put the umpire about there. Our heads linesman is out of position. He should be about here. And if we do that, as you can see, we end up keeping everything boxed in as this play moves forward. As it is, that's not what happens. If this play were to have broken free all the way to the goal line, we would have had nobody at the pylon to rule because line judge let the play progress past him. Again, at this point, if you want to backpedal, that's fine. You could, if you want to think of it like a field judge or a side judge in a college mechanic, that's one way to think of it, because that's kind of what the line judge turns into in this scenario on a free kick. Okay, here we're going to see another one. And on this one, I want to point it out because it's kind of interesting. I get kind of what's happening. First off, we're walking again. I'm not going to mention this other than maybe one more time. But again, guys, I just cannot stress enough, you do not walk as a wing official. Sidestep or run. As the play goes down now, and we see this is gonna progress, and as it comes, what happens is our wing kind of gets into normal scrimmage play mentality. And that is, if this were a scrimmage play, then yes, the wing would need to go like this and get upfield behind the play so that he can come in behind and rule. But this is not a scrimmage play, this is a free kick. So again, we need to stay ahead of it in case it breaks all the way to the goal line. So again, like I said, we're down there to rule. As you can see, he lets it go past. And now we've got nobody down there. Now, luckily, the player stepped out, so we didn't end up with someone at the goal line or play at the goal line that we weren't there to rule on. But again, line judge, umpire, understand it is the umpire's responsibility to cruise up and come in and mark that ball. One other mechanic I thought I'd point out on a free kick is kind of the answer to this question. According to the manual, who does the back judge count and who does the line judge count? Just so that you're aware. And to help you out with the answer, ask yourself, does it really make sense that we would have one guy count the kicking team and four guys count the receiving team? That really doesn't make sense, which is why actually in the manual, both the line judge and the back judge count the kicking team. When you're starting out that game and you're leaning into each other or the free kick and you're turning to each other and saying, I got 11, and the back judge is saying, I got 11. What you're confirming with each other is that you have both counted the kicking team and that you have 11 players. Now, having said that, again, that's what the manual says, but my recommendation for that line judge is that while the back judge is getting things set up, count the kicking team real quick and then turn around and actually count the receiving team as well. It's just a good idea to have them both because you don't want to run off the field if the receiving team only had 10 players and then, you know, we're actually running off as if we were ready when we actually weren't. So manual says for back judge and line judge to count the kicking team. Good idea for the line judge just to count them both. And then we don't ever have that happen. But anyway, something to be aware of and understand actually what is in the manual when it comes to that. Okay, here we're going to move on to just a basic scrimmage play. What I like about this play is it's a great example of crew communication and understanding each other's responsibilities and trusting each other to do what they're supposed to do. Now here we got a play that ran basically for a first down, not by much, barely made it by about a yard. And we can see as we come in and roll forward a little bit, line judge sees, yep, that's the first down. Our head linesman either did one of two things. He either knew where he was on the field so that he knew that they passed the chains for a first down, or he looked across the line judge and confirmed it and could see him killing the clock, so he knew it was a first down. R looks over to the side to see about where we're at. He can instantly see that, man, that's close. So his head immediately kicks over to his line judge to say, hey, line judge, that's close. What do we got? And he can see the line judge is killing the clock. As I roll it forward here, you'll see the line judge kind of point across his chest to signal that it's a first down. And once he does that, then the referee points to the head linesman to tell him to move the chains. Linesman was a little bit fast on the chains. It's always better to be late than early. So a better suggestion, again, would be for the head linesman just to wait half a second till you get that point from the referee and then go ahead and move the chains, and then we make sure we don't ever move them early. But all in all, again, a great mechanic by a crew who understands each other's responsibilities and fulfills them the way they should be on a close first down play. All right, this one we need to back it up just a little bit here to start out. This will be a pass play. We want to kind of go over the basic mechanics for that. We see our line judge again here is signaling that his man is off. And once he does that, across the way, his head linesman sees that and then points forward to signal that his man is on. Now, incidentally, when it comes to signaling who is on and who is off, just to be aware, if this wing was actually up on the line and the head linesman's wing is on the line, these two wings actually have nothing to communicate to each other at that point. The only time we start the communication is if one or both have their furthest out receiver off the line. If they're on the line, they don't need to point to each other saying, I have him on. It's just pointing, saying, hey, my guy's off. Oh, yours is off. Okay, here's what mine is. And then once we do that, it makes it really easy for everybody. Okay, then great. We can count quick and know we've got 4 men in the backfield and our formation is legal. Let's talk about keys. Before the ball is snapped, and I guess at the snap, these are the line judge keys. He's got the two inside receivers. The back judge has the outside receiver. Now, as we run this play forward, what you're going to see is that this receiver is going to roll back for a possible lateral, and this inside receiver is going to streak down the field for a deep pass. So when that happens, our keys are going to change. Let's just go ahead and roll forward and kind of show you what we're talking about. So this play rolls forward, and just kind of like we said, now our keys have changed. This key who's streaking down the field becomes the back judge key because he's going to be down there where the back judge is. This becomes the line judge key that's back here in the backfield, and also this other inside receiver is the line judge key. The line judge at this point then needs to stay put. There is no reason for him to move right now because he has to hit one. This receiver is not more than 10 yards down the field, and he also has to hang out so that he can make sure and rule on a forward or backward pass in case there's a lateral. Right about now, once our inside receiver is 10 yards downfield, then it's time for that wing to move. In fact, as we roll forward, though, it goes to the inside receiver, so the line judge heads downfield, and he and the back judge come in and rule on that play. All right, on this play, as we move forward, line judge key. If we look where we're at, we have our line judge who's sitting still, but his keys, which was here, this inside receiver, is long gone. Much more than 10 yards downfield. And as we roll forward, we can see that this line judge is actually, he's got his head cocked to the back, and he is watching the quarterback, which means we now have two officials watching the same individual. They're both watching the quarterback, the referee and the line judge. Meanwhile, we have no idea what's happening with our key, that inside receiver that's downfield. As we continue to roll this forward, now we swing our head with the ball so that we're kind of here watching the ball go. And again, nobody, we've left that, well, I shouldn't say nobody, but we've left that poor back judge back there all by himself to try to rule on all the receivers and catch everything that's happening. Now, having said all that, there's just one caveat I need to kind of put in on this play and on these as we talk about following keys and not leaving soon enough versus leaving too soon with the rule change this year in regards to intentional grounding, that the quarterback can now dump the ball as long as they're outside the pocket. And when they throw their pass, if they're chucking it out of bounds or just getting rid of it, it has to be beyond this line of scrimmage. It's going to make things a little bit difficult, both for referees and umpires. There hasn't been any clarification directly as of the making of this video from what the NFHS would like the mechanic to be. But somewhere between the umpire and the wings, we need to be aware of where that ball went in regards relationship to the line of scrimmage. So yes, we need to go down with our keys, as I've mentioned in this video. However, somewhere about this point, as we're following our keys down, when we get about 5, 10 yards down the field ourselves, if not sooner, when we feel like we have a second, we can take our eyes off the receiver as we're running. We need to quick look back and see if there's a potential that the quarterback is under duress, and that he may try to dump that football so that we can help rule if necessary on where that line of scrimmage was and if the pass got beyond the line of scrimmage. So everything here that we've talked about in this clip is still holds true. We still need to move with our keys. We just need to kind of be aware of where that line of scrimmage is at and be aware if the passer is in trouble so that in case we need to rule on the line of scrimmage and if the ball got beyond the line of scrimmage. On this next play, I'm going to just let this run. Let me skip ahead a little bit. What we can see is it's going to roll to the sideline, and what happens is our chains are going to get hit. This is just a reminder of our responsibilities in pregame. Make sure that we're having a very thorough discussion with our chain crew. I know many times you're going to go talk to the chain crew, and they'll say, "Yeah, we've done this for 25 years. We know what we're doing." If you get that, your immediate response needs to be great. Then you guys already know what you're doing. I'm going to give you the speech anyway. And review it and go over your entire speech that starts out with, we need to be safe tonight. If a play comes your way, throw the chains down and get out of the way. That's what the clip is for. Don't, again, skip over that. Don't breeze on that. You look here and you can see right now we've got a perfectly straight pole, brand new looking chains. You come in, hit, that pole is no longer straight. And that hurts, by the way. Not only could this young lady have been hurt very badly, but also we could have had players get hurt. So again, it's important that we do our pregame, particularly with the chain crew. And if this happens in a game, don't just turn around and move on. It's time to have another discussion with the chain crew. All right, continuing with scrimmage plays. Here we see that our key, again, that was the inside receiver for our head linesman, is barely 5 yards down the field. There's no reason for that head linesman to be moving yet. But we start to move. As you can see, what this has done, since we moved and didn't hang tight to see where the pass was going to go, particularly because we could, because our key was not more than 10 yards down the field, now we end up putting ourselves in danger. Because this play is going to come right at this head linesman, and instead of trying to get back upfield out of the way and correcting this problem, instead what this head linesman does is he just simply backs up. And then as the play comes toward him, not only are you in danger of hurting yourself, but it becomes very difficult to try to rule on fouls and where the ball should be spotted and so forth when this car crash is coming right at you. And boom, we get hit. This one's another example we want to hit real quickly of just getting ahead of the play. See, we want to be back here in this position where we can easily rule and not be in danger, can easily see what we need to. We get ahead of the play here. This is just asking for disaster. If this is how we continue to officiate, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when you finally get your knees taken out and get hurt. Additionally, we have our whistle in our mouth. We, as football officials, we don't ref the play with our whistles in our mouth. That's also asking for injury and to get hurt. Or, best case scenario, you end up giving an IW at some time because you blow your whistle when you didn't mean to. So keep our whistles out of our mouth and then keep back from the play so that we don't get hit. See, we're trying to keep ourselves safe. Now, do we really know where he went out of bounds? I don't think we do because we were just trying to not get hurt. Next thing, real quick. Same type of scenario. We run down, sorry, I skipped ahead a lot, but as we run down, we're getting too close to the play. We want to be anywhere from 7 to even 15 yards behind the play is better than being right up on it. But this is too close. This is too close to rule. And then also watch this signal. We want our signals to be chest high. This is a safe call in baseball. See? Okay, let's talk about keys again. We can see that the inside key, this will be the back judge key, and he's on his way down, but our inside key is right here. There is no reason for us as a line judge to start moving. We've already taken off. Okay, we want to hang tight a little bit longer, make sure this is clear, make sure that we'll let the play develop, and not leave until our keys are at least 10 yards down the field. And then here again on this play, as I mentioned before, it's even more important that we don't leave too soon because with the rule change again for intentional grounding, we may need to help on whether or not that ball got behind the line of scrimmage. And even more so, we don't want to leave too soon. In fact, at this point, again, until we get some further clarification from an FHS on the mechanic, better to leave a little late than to leave a little early because we will have to rule sometimes or help sometimes on whether or not that ball got across the line of scrimmage. Okay, this is the last time I'm going to talk about this. But again, I hope that if anything else, when we get done with this training, everybody knows, and we don't see this happen anymore with Utah officials, with individuals walking during a play. Again, I'm sure this official cares a lot about what they're doing, but what's happening here makes it appear that they don't. The play is dead. We should have come down here at a right angle and be, I'm a little off on my spot, but should be have come in, be charging in with our spot, at least to the numbers. But instead, we're still walking down the field. And we still haven't come in. We still haven't come in. Then we kind of give a half-hearted 40-second play clock signal. This is not the level of professionalism that we need to see. As officials of high school football, we need to show more hustle than that we saw there, and we need to make sure we're hustling and running or sidestepping on every single play. Okay, on this one, we kind of forget some of our responsibilities. We're running down the field as a head linesman. Yes, we never look back to see where the chains are, but we can see right here, we're running forward. we should be able to kind of out of the corner of our eye at least or see it go by, let alone kind of know where it's at, so that we should know, man, we just passed the line to gain. This is a first down. We need to kill the clock. If we're not sure, that's where our line judge can help us out with. Look across the field, see if he's killing it. We're coming up with a 40-second play clock signal. That is the incorrect signal for this situation. Now, the really interesting thing here as we roll forward is this: is that this head linesman will actually turn and start signaling to move his chains, which means we know it's a first down, but for some reason we've chosen the incorrect signal. So, again, first down, first thing we do, kill the clock. Okay. Here again, we move a little bit too quick. There's no reason to move yet. There's no reason to make our eyes bounce. We can hold still and get a better view of the play and the things that we're trying to rule on. We don't want to move until we have to move. See, we've kind of started moving. Now we got to backtrack. If we would have just stayed put, again, let me back up into that one, sorry. If we would have just stayed put where we were, this play would have developed, it would have backtracked, and all we would have done is gone like this and come in and marked our spot. But here we kind of moving forward, moving backward, when, again, we could have just been holding our eyes still and ruling from a relaxed and easier to view situation without our eyes bouncing. Here we want to talk about squaring off and why it's important. We got a few of these we'll look at, but as this play comes in, we've drifted out onto the field already, and what you're going to see is that this head linesman is going to wander out, and then because the play sits and goes back and forth, we kind of do this, and really begins to look like we're lost because we're changing where our spot is at. It's more than just looking professional and sharp to come in with a 90 degree angle. What you need to understand that as an official, as a wing, when you come onto the field marking the spot of where the ball is, you're making a call. You're coming out on the field saying, this is where the spot is at. If you change that and move back and forth as you come on, or if you banana in, what you're essentially doing is with every step, you are changing your call. I'm coming in, the spot's here, nope, it's here, nope, it's here, nope, it's here. That's not what we want to do. We want to stay on the sideline till we know exactly where the spot is, and then as we come on, we are making a call to everybody saying, here's where it's at. I'm going to let this play, and you can kind of see what I'm talking about, that we change our mind, that it's here. Oh, well, now it's still alive. I guess we're here. No, we're here. And actually, I guess we're here. Now, again, I'm not belittling this official. I want you to make you understand that. I'm just trying to show you what it looks like as you watch that. But again, if we stay off the field, we don't end up looking like we're changing our call. Here we'll see a perfect example of what we're talking about. Line judge waited until it was time. Now he's going to run in, and you'll see him come in with a perfect 90-degree angle, steps in, here's your spot. Another example of line judge doing what we've kind of been talking about, not moving until it's required. A good rule of thumb is once the ball gets to the numbers, that's when it's time to shift upfield if you need to get back behind the play so that you don't get run over. And we'll see this head linesman does exactly that. Play will roll, it's out here, he lets it come, it's outside the numbers, he steps back, and he can make his call. Didn't move any more than was required. Okay, here we've got a sample example of an official being too focused on their spot. You can see that with his head position and see exactly where his eyes are moving. As he steps forward, you're going to see that he's still there looking. Now he does the cardinal sin and turns his back on the players. If something unsportsmanlike happens right here, we've got a player, an opposing bench, we won't see it, because we've turned our back on it. Sometimes we get it in our head for some reason that we need to face the field to make our signals. There's absolutely no reason to do that. So we want to keep the players in view. Okay, this is the good positioning that we want to see. Here you're going to have this come out to the sideline again. I want you to watch how this official moves. As it comes, he's going to step back to let the play go past him. And then he knows where his spot is. Now he's going to clear out and get a good view of the other players as he makes his call. That's the perfect movement that we want to see happen as the play comes out of bounds. Okay, let's move into scrimmage kick mechanics. So here we got a standard scrimmage kick formation that we can see. One thing to be aware of as wings, scrimmage kicks are a lot of times where things go wrong. It's not something that a team practices as much as they practice their other plays. So this is a situation where you a lot of times can have an illegal formation. Don't go to sleep. Pay attention. Somebody will come out. They haven't been here for a while, and so he'll do something like this guy will line up off the line. If he does that, we're going to have 5 men in the backfield, and this is an illegal formation. So just be aware of that. Don't fall asleep. Be alert and free kick, or sorry, scrimmage kick formations, that this is where things can go wrong, particularly when it comes to formations. All right, we're going to let this go. It was a legal formation. We had 4 in the backfield. The receivers are both on the line, so we don't have anything to communicate to each other as far as these wings go. He doesn't need to point and tell him. He doesn't need to point and tell him anything. There's nothing to communicate. The wings are on the line. Okay, per the manual, the requirement on a scrimmage kick is that the line judge leaves at the snap. So that's what we do, exactly what we want to see. The manual says the line judge leaves at the snap. It also says the head linesman will leave once the ball crosses the zone. Now, I know you will hear sometimes individuals who will say that the line judge should maybe hang out a bit or wait to make sure that there's not a blocked kick or, at the very least, a fumbled snap. Let me explain to you why that is incorrect and why it's not a valid concern. That is exactly the reason why we have the head linesman stay and not leave until the ball leaves the zone. If we have the head linesman and the line judge stay, now we have 3 people all watching the same thing. And only one guy, poor back judge, all alone back there trying to watch everything. Also understand that you have 3 guys watching the same play that doesn't really happen very often. 9 times out of 10, the snap is clean, the kick is made, and the ball goes downfield. We do not need the line judge to stay put. He needs to leave the moment the ball is snapped, and then we still have the head linesman and the referee who are watching in case there is a blocked kick or a bobbled snap. At that point, the line judge can turn around and come back to help out as necessary, but he's kind of a secondary official to come in later to help with that. So again, line judge leaves on the snap. Head linesman leaves as the ball crosses the zone. As we roll forward, you'll see that now, because the line judge came downfield, he can help out with this first, well, I'll be able to get that guy in there too, this first wave of blockers, and it allows the back judge to simply focus on the return man and look for kick catch interference and so forth. As the play continues, line judge is still moving down. If it would have been caught and moved forward, it would have mattered a little bit more on this play, but this second wave of blockers is what the head linesman is picking up as he comes down, with the umpire and the referee kind of doing cleanup behind. Guys, that is the mechanic for a scrimmage kick. And like I said, there's reasons for it. We only have 5 officials. We have to keep everything covered. All right, let's move on to the next play. This one, good job again by the line judge. And there is a foul that happens, and because he went downfield like he should, he's able to pick that stuff up. Now, I'll point out one thing. Watch this line judge's head as he moves down the field. Great mechanic. He starts to sidestep. He's moving, but he is still kind of keeping his eye on the ball. And that's fine, just as long as we're moving and heading in the direction that we need to be. Now we're coming down, and as we get down here, there is a big blindside block that's going to happen right here. Boom. And because our line judge was positioned in the correct spot, he's able to pick that up. We get a good job getting it. The other thing that I like that this line judge does is after he throws his flag, he continues to officiate. Heads down the field, runs with the play, gets his spot. Now he can run down, tell the white hat what he has. Next item, goal line mechanics. We can see here on this play that we are right at the 5-yard line, essentially. It's a great example of getting to the goal line first and then working back. The goal line is the line that matters. So we need to make sure that is covered because our back judge has given it up. So this head linesman does a great job getting to the goal line, and then once he realizes that it's not threatened, he works back to come in and spot the play. Starts the hustle. I've got to get the goal line covered. Then he sees I don't need to, and he works back to come in and mark the spot. That is exactly the mechanic that we need to see on the goal line when we are going in, when there's a potential touchdown. Okay, similar scenario here. Back judge has given up the goal line. We are on about the 4 yard line, or no, we're on the 3 yard line. So we know that as wings, we should be moving to the goal line instantly the moment the ball is snapped. Let's get pad here. The ball is snapped. We can see again, just out of reach there. If I back it up, that our head linesman again has taken off to get to the goal line like he should. Now this play comes and it actually goes to the back of the end line. The wing has moved to the goal line like he should, and now he's going to watch for PI. However, as this play goes forward, you can see this is not the line judge's call to make, whether it's a touchdown or not. It's on the end line. That is the back judge's call. Now the wing is looking to the back judge to see if he needs help, but if it's a touchdown, that's not the line judge's call to make. If it's incomplete, that's not the line judge's call to make. We're going to look to the back judge and see if he has it. If he has it, that's his call. If he's looking at you for some help, then we can let him know that, shake our head, nod our head, whatever. But even then, that's going to be the back judge who signals based upon your feedback. And we can see the back judge, it was incomplete. He signaled incomplete. Okay, let's talk about communication on the goal line. We're going to skip forward on this a little bit. This play is going to go down to the goal line. We're going to break free. We have some great things that happen here. The back judge moved, he was at halfway between the goal line and the end line like he should be. As the run play developed, he moved up to the goal line just like he should. Now the responsibility, if it crosses the goal line and is a touchdown, that's going to be the back judge's call to make because he has the goal line. The wing, whichever side he's on, is not going to signal touchdown if we have a touchdown. Interestingly enough, this is kind of a little bonus that we would have picked up, but we watch here. That is a cheap, dirty shot. Nobody saw it because our wing is running down the field to signal touchdown when that's not his call to make. We can see our poor back judges over here. He's pointing, doing the correct mechanics, saying, hey, wing, did he step out of bounds or did he not? And that's all we're going to do is either nod to him or point to him to say, yep, he stayed in, and then the back judge will make the determination if the ball crossed the goal line. Incidentally, like I said, if we would have been looking towards the back judge like we should have been as a wing, we would have seen this dirty hit happen. But instead, we're running forward to make a call that's not our call to make, and we come in and also pile on with the mistakes here and turn our back on the players. There's no reason to square up to the field. Wings, you will work with a lot of back judges who, if you take that call away from them and signal touchdown when that was not your goal line, you're going to hear it from them. All you do is tell the back judge whether he stayed in or not, and then the back judge determines if it was a touchdown or not because that's his goal line. It's important that we do the correct mechanics because there are times when this play, you know, it was maybe an easier call to make, but there are times when it is not, and we need to do the correct mechanic every single time. Here we have reverse goal line mechanics. We are inside the five, so again, according to the manual, the instant the ball is snapped as wings, we move to the goal line to cover it in case we have a potential safety. This play is going to roll forward, and we're going to see there's going to be a fumble. The ball's bouncing around on the one or the two. There could have been potential for a safety there. We should have had wings kicked back to the goal line, ready to rule on that. Incidentally, while we're at it, get this yokel out of here. Maybe he's not as close as he appears, but that looks to me like he's right where a wing should be standing to rule on the goal line. Get those guys out of here. Clean up your sideline. Clean up your goal line. Great hustle, by the way, line judge crashing in to make the call. Okay, more goal line mechanics. This one's going in, so we have potential for a touchdown. We're starting at about the 15-yard line. This play's from a little while ago, so I believe the back judge gives up the goal line a little bit early. I think nowadays, again, we follow the manual, which says the back judge gives it up at about the 10-yard line. But the point here is that in this crew, the back judge has, in fact, given up the goal line. He's on the back end line, which means as wings, we have got to get to the goal line ahead of the play. This is another one of some of those scenarios where we don't go upfield and let the play go past us. We have to stay ahead of the play and be at the goal line waiting to rule. In this scenario, it doesn't happen. We let the play get ahead of us. This becomes a dive for the goal line. Look, if we're standing over here where we should be, we got a clear view. We can easily tell if that ball crossed, if he stepped out before, if he didn't, and we can rule on it. Because we aren't, We come in, I think we get the call right, and we call it short. But as a coach, if I'm watching that, I don't believe you. You didn't have a good look. You weren't positioned where you're supposed to be. You don't know if he got in or not, and I'm going to come yell at you. If we do the correct mechanics and get ourselves positioned about right here, or maybe even a little bit further back, we have a great view. It becomes very believable that, hey, I'm right on it. I see it. I know what I got. Okay, one other point to make. I kind of mentioned it on the last play, but you can see, look where we're standing. Now, we're on the goal line, which is great, but we are straddling that pylon. That puts us in danger. We're basically in the field of play and could be injured. We want to be positioned about 4 yards off of the goal line so that we can safely have the correct view and not need to move or run or get out of the way so that we don't get hurt. As it is, luckily we didn't, but we could have potentially been hurt on that play. All right, here's an example of a goal line mechanic that we want to see. He is moving to the goal line like he should, stays ahead of the play. As the play comes in, now he's 4 yards off. He's got a great view. He can watch it without any danger of being hurt and easily make the call, which was just short. Okay, PAT, something that some people know and some people don't. And what we're talking about is crashing in on a PAT. So we've got whichever wing is on the side and the other is up underneath the uprights. Once that kick is made on a PAT, this is where you've got a bunch of guys pushing, shoving each other. It's a good idea to come charging in, help out the umpire. We've got an umpire here, and we got a wing here all crashing in saying, that's enough, break it up, break it up. Get one color going one way and the other color going the other way so that we just kind of have our presence there and it can help break up fights. On this next clip, we're going to have a fake PAT or field goal attempt. In this case, it's a point after attempt, or as we sometimes call it, a fire drill. We want to go over the mechanics for everybody on that particular wing so that when it happens, we don't have a deer in the headlights moment and everybody freezes. We'll let this roll forward here a little bit. As we can see, we're on a point after attempt. We have the headlinesman underneath the uprights and it becomes a fake. When that happens, these two arrows, the umpire, and in this case it was the headlinesman, need to immediately, once they recognize that we have a fake, begin to move into their alternate positions. For the wing, would need to instantly begin to move as fast as they can to the corner pylon. The umpire, for his part, is going to instantly move up to the goal line to help rule in case, and like we have happening here, this is going to roll this direction. So it would be the in that scenario, the umpire who comes up to the goal line and rules whether or not we have a successful, it's a two-point conversion. So we're going to let this roll forward. We see what happens is, and in fact, everybody freezes. We have a pass that comes into the end zone. We've got a question here. That's neither here nor there. But now, as you can see, if I back that up, our umpire is just kind of standing there, not sure what he was supposed to do. This is actually his call, not our wing, who was nowhere near getting over to where they needed to be, and instead comes in and signals touchdown. Luckily, this one wasn't a close call. It wasn't required to have somebody on the goal line, so that this crew kind of lucked out. But really, we need to understand everybody's position and where they go. Okay, those are our goal line mechanics. Let's talk about signaling and the type of signals and how we want to signal. I'm going to skip forward here a little bit. As this play develops, I want you to watch what this looks like as the wing signals incomplete. What we want to do is come to a stop and make a good, solid signal. I'm going to back this up a couple times and go through, but watch the way we signal. We're struggling and we're trying to get our signals in. It just doesn't look very in control and professional. Come to a stop. I don't know what this pointing is. I've watched this play a few times. I don't know why we're pointing or what we would be pointing at. That's also not a mechanic or anything that you'd see. Just come in, make your signal, and get back to your pregame positions or pre-snap positions. Here's a great example. Now compare that one with the way this looks. Here we got an incomplete pass. We got our wing headed downfield. You'll watch him come to a stop. Boom. Love it. It gives a single signal because it's obvious to everybody that was incomplete. The ball's bouncing out on the track. Begins, we come together, come to a stop, give a nice solid signal. Huge difference in professionalism and credibility as others see you working on the field. Here we're not paying attention to our keys. The correct mechanic for wing officials is that if you are the whichever side you're on, you have this side of the ball if you're on this side of the field, and the wing on the other side has the other side of the ball. All you take is your side of the ball and let your partner take the other side of the ball. Trust your partner to make the call. This false start happens. We actually end up with multiple people moving on defense and offense again as we roll forward. We're going to have our head linesman throw his flag. There is no reason for him to be throwing a flag on this play. Now, if you're a head linesman, what you do is you hang tight for half a second, because obviously this is a big one. We have to call this. Give your partner a chance to do his job. Trust him that he will, and give him a chance to do it. If for some reason he didn't see it, and we had a big miss, okay, then you can step in there and throw your flag. But because we both throw our flag on this play, we got two flags in the air. That means both of you have seen something different in your keys, and you need to run in, and he needs to crash in at full speed, and you need to come together in the middle and talk to make sure you have the same thing before either of you go and talk to the white hat. Okay, what I want to talk about is the mechanic for when you have a false start. Because look at both teams. They're coming together to crash, they're going to start fighting. Half of them are going to hear your whistle, and half of them are not. And the one guy that doesn't hear it, he's going to start hitting the guy that did hear it, which is going to make that guy mad. And then they start pushing and shoving, and now you have a fight break out. So when we have a false start, that it's not a spot foul, we are going to take that flag and chuck it high into the air where it draws attention from everybody that a flag is flying, and then we're going to get on our whistle and tweet, 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 tweet for all we're worth as we come running in to perhaps break up the fighting that's going on or move into to signal to our white hat. Here we just kind of chucked our flag down on the ground. That's not the throw that we want to see. Watch how this line judge makes this call. This is the mechanic that we want to see on a false start. He's looking, it's going to jump. That flag goes high in the air and he runs full speed. You can see his eyes, he's looking, but he can see there's no danger of pushing and shoving. So he turns and runs straight to his white hat. Hey, I got a false start. Let me back that up one more time. Let's watch it again. This is the correct mechanic. Flag goes high in the air. We run full speed in onto the field saying false start, and let them know what we have. Signal the white hat, and we can administer the penalty and move on. Okay, here we're going to have officials out on the field that shouldn't be. Here we've kind of drifted out. Now we're on the field. We did it too quick. See, we don't want to rush or hurry things. This ball is going to come out. We want to make sure that the play is over before we start to come out on the field. Now, because when that happens, you suddenly find yourself out in no man's land, and now we've got to change our position. So as we came in here, see, we actually came out on the field about here, and now we've had to shift and move up to where the ball actually went in, and or where it was down. And essentially, we just changed our call. We don't want to do that. Take your time, stay off the field, wait till the down is actually over. And then come in with your spot. Okay, it's important that we don't give up on the play. A couple things happen here. We get suckered in. There's going to be a fumble. Fumble is the correct call. The ball comes out. But I don't know if we thought there was going to be a pile up, and so we started coming onto the field. But for whatever reason, we came out too quick. And the ball is now live, and we're out on the field. And then our reaction here from the line judge is, oh well. And as we move forward, the play leaves us behind. See, we just turned and started looking at other things. Maybe I don't know if we didn't see that the ball was out or what, but this guy's full speed. We're never going to catch him at this point. We're never going to be in a position to rule. Poor White Hat does the best he can, but we kind of just got sucked out on the field and then gave up on the play. Again, take our time and don't come in until it's required. Okay, let's talk about spots. Here's where the ball is at, is down. Now we've got a first down, but you know what? Line judge, you don't actually know where the ball is at for sure because it's on the opposite side of the field. This is going to be H's responsibility to determine exactly where the spot is. So what we've done here is we've just rushed. What you don't want to have happen is if you come in and start killing the clock, and all of a sudden, the H saw something because it was over on his side that you didn't, and he comes in right here. Now, what are you going to do? Oh no. Everybody's going to see it and we're going to have a big problem. So take your time. Wait to see what the ruling official has. Again, per the mechanics manual, you are not the ruling official on this play. The head linesman is. I believe as this goes forward, well, I think they come in, both of them have. We end up okay because this is a first down. We're making the wrong signal here. We should be killing the clock. So it doesn't end up to bite us too much, but again, that could have been really bad if that were to happen, the scenario I just played out. So, whosoever side of the field it is, that's who takes the spot. Okay? And who's ever on the opposite side of the field, the only thing you do is mirror your partner's position. If you can't see him, either because you've got a big crest in the field, you're working at Bountiful or whatever, or you got players in the way, then don't come on the field. Don't take a spot. In fact, stand sideways. Don't even try to take a position until you can see where your partner is on the other side of the field, who has marked that spot and whose call it is to make. Okay, on this one, we're gonna have a similar situation. Now I've looked at it. I'm actually not sure that we got the right spot by the line judge, but what matters is it's the line judge's call to make. Ball's down here. He felt that a knee was down before, and that's where the ball was at. Whether it's right or wrong is neither here nor there. The point is, it's the line judge's call. You're not going to be able to overrule that from clear over there. And now we got two guys lined up in completely different spots. That poor umpire, when it comes to spot the ball, is going to not know what to do, and everybody's going to be watching. Oh, let's back this up a little bit. This is going to be a little bit controversial for some. However, per the mechanics manual, and also per a vote by the joint board, there is no such thing as a double punch. See, what's happening here is we have this guy off and this guy off. And so we've got it in our head that, well, since that happens, I better communicate that they're both off. That is heading down a slippery slope. It's also does a few things. It's signaling things that we don't need to signal to each other. It draws undue attention to ourselves. And again, it's not part of the mechanic of what we would do. All we're worried about with that signal is what this receiver is at, whether he's on or he's off. We don't need to signal anything about this inside receiver. I'll let you watch out. Some might be wondering, what is a double punch? Well, here, watch this official. This is what a double punch is. Boom, boom. Okay, we don't do that. We've voted on it. It's also not in the manual. Do not do the double punch. Here we're going to see it again. Let me back it up. We got our hand out. There is no such mechanic as a double punch. Boom, boom. I won't give you my personal thoughts on it other than just to say that it's not in the manual, so we don't do it. Okay, some other things to think about. Here we got an official. He's got two things he wants to signal. He figures, I'll just signal them both at the same time. Okay, this is not doing two signals. You're actually signaling a completely different thing. And some people are going to look at it and say, does this guy think he's in college? Because this is a college substitution signal. Don't combine signals. Don't make up signals and do new things on your own. Again, what it looks like is that you're trying to draw attention to yourself. Hey, everybody, look at me. I'm making signals. I'm doing weird things. Don't do that. Make your signals separate. What he's signaling here is, just in case anybody's not clear, he's signaling that, hey, my guy is off, and also I have 11 players to the back judge. First signal, 11 players to the back judge as the play's setting up. Then as the players get set, drop your one hand, and then raise your other hand to signal your guy is off, if that's what you have. If I'm H over there, I'm looking at, and I don't even know what you're trying to tell me. Okay, that is not a mechanic that we use. That is not a signal that's a high school mechanic. So don't do that. Don't combine signals. I said we weren't going to talk about flags that we should or shouldn't call, but other than just the mechanic of guys, we need to keep control of our sideline. Keep the coaches back where we need to. This coach actually steps in front of this official as he goes by. That's not okay. We need to do something about that. We had a flag. We didn't see it. There was a hold call or something that we had on that. But then what happened is we give up on this play. We know that we have a flag, so we know this touchdown is going to come back. But even so, we still need to finish the play so that everybody knows this play ended in a touchdown. So we still need to come in. We need to look over to our back judge. Sorry, I overrode him there. And let him know, point to him, and say, yep, my guy stayed in, so that the back judge can effectively signal touchdown. Then once that's done, Then we can loop back around and come talk to our white hat and let him know what we have. If you watch this official, he comes in and says, okay, I'm leaving. And he runs back to go talk to his white hat, I guess because he didn't want to run all the way down and back. But that's not the mechanic that we want to see. That's not professional. Finish the play. Do our mechanic to our line judge. Let him signal touchdown. Get down here about somewhere where we should be. And then, yep, you're going to have to turn around and run back to the white hat and go talk to him. That's our job. Okay, now we want to talk for just a second about another area where we can lose credibility as officials if we don't rule things correctly or use the correct philosophy and mechanic and understanding of the rules. What we're going to have here is a play that runs to the sideline and out of bounds. We have a grab that happens right here. And what we're talking about is winding the clock and when to not wind and when to kill the clock when the play goes out of bounds. You got a little bit of grab here, continues on, steps out right here, and runs forward out of bounds. And then what we're going to see here is that our wing official is going to wind the clock in that scenario. Okay, guys, there is absolutely no way that we can justify winding the clock when our player has just run, hasn't even lost his footing, is running out forward out of bounds. We wind the clock in this situation, and what we've just sent, or the message that we've just sent to everybody on the field is, we don't want to be here. We just want to get this game over and get out of here and go home as fast as we can. And again, it will cause you to lose credibility with coaches and fans and everybody watching the game. We'll see another one here, kind of the same thing. Ball's run forward, he gets hit. Now I know there has been, as I've talked with officials, some had thought that the rule was if the player gets hit and knocked out of bounds, that you wind the clock. That is not the case. The only time that we would wind the clock when a player goes out of bounds is if their forward progress is stopped and they are pushed backwards and then out of bounds. If we're falling forward out of bounds, running forward out of bounds, if we come in here and wind the clock, we just lose all credibility. Please remember, we only wind the clock if forward progress is stopped. If it goes out of bounds, falling forward or moving forward, we need to kill the clock. This play here, we don't want to watch the ball. The ball's going to go where the ball's going to go. If we're on a scrimmage kick, ball gets kicked into the air. I want you to pay attention to the line judge's head. See, he's up watching the ball. We got no idea if this guy's punching this guy in the face or somebody's kicking somebody or whatever because we're ball watching. We don't need to watch where that ball is. We can take a quick glance, but it's best if we can't see the ball because that means we're focusing on the blocks that we should be on. We keep our head on the ball all the way out until it went out of bounds. And again, we kind of lost focus and didn't focus on our keys as we should. So on kicks, that includes free kicks as well. Just work on breaking that habit. Do a quick check so you kind of get an idea of where it's going. But you don't want your head swinging following the ball. We need to focus on our keys. Okay, we are about out of time. So I just want to hit a few final comments on professionalism and way to make ourselves look better and look more like we know what we're doing and professional as officials. Here we're going to talk about some more signals that are non-high school signals. There are some officials who like to do the completed catch signal. Let's be clear, that is not a high school mechanic. That is a college mechanic. We're not going to tell you you can't do it, but it should be used very sparingly. Not just any time that we have a catch. And here we get too fixated on the ball and so forth, and we're going to watch it a couple times. Just want you to kind of look at, again, not trying to be hard on this official, but sometimes it's good to just look on film and see how this looks. I'm going to back it up one more time and let you watch that. That's us trying to say it was a catch. We don't need to signal it was a catch. Everybody knows it's a catch when we come in and mark the spot, and then what we would do, because I believe this was an interception, is we would then point the other way and say, turnover. And then everybody knows that we have a catch and an interception. We don't need to do a non-high school mechanic to try to signal that. Also here, with that one, we just signaled a catch, we put the ball down, and we never pointed other direction, turnover. I believe we got an end zone view here to watch as well. You can kind of see it a little bit better as he'll run in. Because we got, I would say this too, look, we don't need to worry about the ball until it's time to worry about the ball. We just had a big play here. Come in, signal the position, Kill the clock and point the other direction, and then start looking for the ball. Okay, we got things we need to do first. We come in, grab the ball, then we want to say catch, and we ended up kind of doing almost a choo-choo train motion there because we hung on to the ball with one hand. Again, not to be too critical, but let's focus on the high school mechanics and get those first. Okay, just something else to be aware of. We normally signal twice. Whatever it is that we're signaling, we signal twice. We've already come in, we've already signaled it, I think, twice by the time this play is one, two, now we're here. And again, just pay attention to what this looks like. Three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10. We don't need to signal to kill the clock 10 times unless for some reason we look and the clock isn't stopping. Okay, just come in, signal twice, and move on. And that is the final clip that we'll end on. That again is our training series for the 2022 clinic for wing officials. This will, viewing this video, will count towards your credit of the two videos that you're required to watch for playoff eligibility. Thanks for your time, and good luck.